Hello, everybody. You're listening to Faith with Magnifying Glass, a podcast to analyze several aspects from the Catholic faith with the guide of the Spanish writer and expert in eschatology themes, Maria Vallejo Nájera. This is the first episode we record in English. If you enjoy it, please stay tuned to follow the next episodes. You can follow us in Spotify and other free podcast platforms. Look for us in Instagram in @FeConLupa, which is the Spanish translation of Faith with Magnifying Glass. Today we have a very special episode because Maria is not going to talk as an expert, but she's going to tell us all her testimony of conversion. Faith with Magnifying Glass, with Gabriel López Nieto and Maria Vallejo Nájera. I am so glad to present today Maria Vallejo Nájera, who is a writer, a very famous Catholic writer here in Madrid and all over the world. You know, her books have been translated to many languages. And now we have the honor to be the first to tell in English for all the English speakers all over the world her testimony of conversion. Well, Maria, I'm so happy to have you here. Thank you again. And we're going to have you here many more times. So please stay tuned to the podcast in Spotify and all the nets that we're going to stay tuned. And Maria, just tell us, how are you here? How do you feel now?
Well, first of all, thank you so much, Gabriel. I'm so so grateful to be here with you. It has been a very long time since I last told my testimony in English. The last time I gave this testimony was at Harvard University in 2017, when I had the beautiful chance to went there at my age, at 43 then, I'm 55 now, to give this talk and to study, and I used that staying to give to my peers, to my friends and colleagues in the masters, in the fellowship. There was a fellowship, this testimony of faith. Yes, I'm a writer. I've been writing since 2000, really since 99. Long time ago, Gabriel, a long time ago. And since then, 14 books. The first one was very atheist. It was, I was not a believer then. I didn't believe in God. I was a Catholic, but I didn't understand at all what it was to be a Catholic. I went to Mass on Mass on Sundays, really grabbed by my husband, who was a little more believer than me. We had three children then, and I converted in 2000, precisely when I had just finished that first book, who almost won the most important literary prize here in Spain, which is called the Planeta Prize, Literary Planeta Prize. I didn't win. Now I'm very happy that I didn't win. I lost a lot of money. The price was very, very high. But I didn't, and I think the Lord was behind it, because the protagonist, the main character, was a priest, and I was making fun of him, a Catholic priest, no? It was a complete, an invented story. It was not based on true events. But just after that first book, I had this incredible conversion. It was a contact with God face to face. It was an amazing thing in my life. And since then, I was so incredibly embarrassed that I said, Lord, please forgive me. I've done so much harm. Thank you for not having permitted for me to win that prize, that award. And now I want to work only for you. And since then, 13 more books, all of them based on theology and eschatology subjects, all based on true events, people who told me their incredible, amazing, beautiful stories with God, encounters with God, with Our Lady. You know, we Catholics, we have a lot of love for the Mother of Jesus, Mary. And since then, all my work has been done for Him, to Him, and it will always be for Him. I want to tell you that I'm the same person, okay? Since that conversion, since that incredible experience, I'm the same person, but completely in opposite sides in subjects of faith. So, you know, I'm ready to open my heart to you, Gabriel. You can ask whatever you want.
I'm going to do it. Well, I'm sure you've worked hard to, you know, repair the possible effects of that book that you have told us about. But now, before going to your conversion, I would like you to tell our listeners, how was your life before this conversion? I mean, you said maybe sometimes you went to the mass and on Sundays, but in a daily life, were you a deep person, or Do you like to reflect about life, or were you just a little superficial, or how were you?
Well, I was the typical girl from Madrid, Spain. I belonged to a wealthy family. I didn't lack anything in my life, like food or education. My father was a very, very famous doctor here in my country. So I went to the best schools, Ivy Leagues, universities, whatever, you name it. I had it all. And then I fell in love with this beautiful man who has been married to me for 31 years. It's a long, long time.
Oh, congrats.
I fell madly in love. And he was a believer, not as much as I am now, let's say it, but he was very well prepared. I wasn't. I went to a Catholic school, but it didn't prepare me well. And you know why, Gabriel? Because our country, Spain, had a social Catholicism. After the Civil War in 1936, let's say the right side of the politician movement won that war. With Spain was not communist, was the opposite. So the religion and Catholics was like an obligatory, compulsory thing. We all had to go to mass. Everybody got married in the church. So it was like a social thing. And I got married that way when I had my first Holy Communion without understanding at all what it was. And then when I got married, I was very happy with my white dress and the veil and everything, not understanding the sacrament, not understanding it at all. So that was my life, very social. And we went to live in London. My husband is a nuclear engineer. And I studied education, children's psychology. It's called pedagogy in Spain. No, it's a mixture of education and children's psychology. Beautiful. But after we got married, very soon I got pregnant with twins. So I decided to leave that and just took care of my children. And I went to mass on Sundays because of my husband, and because he was pushing me. He was telling me, you know, Maria, we are living in an Anglican country. We were living in London. We lived in London for almost 9 years, maybe a little longer. But my husband was worried because he said, one day our children will have to choose if they want to be Anglican or if they want to be Catholic. I think it's our choice to educate them in the Catholic system, the Catholic Church. And I said, I was like, this is very boring. I don't want to do that. I don't like to go to mass. I get sleepy in mass. I was like that, no? My friends were all socialites. I liked to go to Harrods and have tea and go partying. And that was my life. A very social, normal life for a, you know, wealthy person, or, well, I don't know how to call it. But my soul was very, not dark, because I was not committing very bad sins or whatever, but it was like dormant. It was dormant. I didn't understand how it was to be a Catholic. And that was the state of my soul when everything changed.
Okay, and then what happened? Why everything changed?
Everything changed because I still have this wonderful English friend. She's my best English friend. She's called Christina. And she was an Anglican, and she had been traveling to Bosnia during the war. She's a wonderful, wonderful lady, and also very wealthy. And she used a lot of her power, the power she had on her hands, to help the poorest of the poor in the Bosnian war. And that touched very much my heart. When she came back from that ministries that she was doing there, she told me, you know what? I found this little village. It's called Medjugorje in the middle of Bosnia-Herzegovina. And you know, there are six guys there. They are young kids. Well, young kids, they were in their early 30s there. Then I was like 32, 33. Now I'm 55. And these visionaries, supposedly visionaries, are my same age. So they were in their early 30s. And she said to me, you know what, Maria, I think they see Our Lady. They assert everybody that they see Our Lady. They have these incredible messages. And this little village was never bombed during the war because Our Lady promised then that she was going to protect the whole town. And it was like, what? what are you talking about? You're nuts. I knew about Fatima. I knew about Lourdes. I didn't know about any other apparition because Spain is close to Portugal. And it's like a famous site for prayers. But I thought, you know, this is old stuff. It sounded to me like medieval stuff, you know. So okay. I was like,
I would like to ask you something before you continue, because I'm very interested. But was your friend Anglican, or why was she interested in the Mother of God?
Well, she was very surprised because she went to Bosnia, as I said, to help in the war, or after the war, to bring money and food. And I think they brought also mattresses and blankets and things like that. I'm not sure about exactly what they did, but they did a lot of things, herself and her sister, both of them Anglican. But somehow they ended up in Medjugorje. And okay. I think a friend took them there, and she was like, wow, what's going on here? So she was immediately drawn to Our Lady, interested. She met the visionaries. She saw many supernatural things there. And what really stuck her heart was the faith of the people. She was like, wow, I never seen this before. It was a very hard time. It was about 98, 99. The war had just finished by then. And there was a lot of soldiers. And actually, we have the Spaniards, we had our soldiers there. Their site was just very close in the outskirts of Medjugorje, very close to Mostar, which has been, by the way, bombarded completely. And it's only 30 minutes away from, you know, the distance is 30 kilometers away from Medjugorje. So she was dumbstruck. And she went, when she came back to London, she said, I'm going to call my friend Maria. She's Catholic. I have to share with her everything I found out in Medjugorje. So what happened, Gabriel, was that she insisted, and she was like a pain in the neck because she was like insisting every time we had tea together. She was like, you know, we shouldn't be less frivolous. I mean, coming it from her, who was a very wealthy, very posh lady in London, was like, what? What are you talking about? She learned how to pray the rosary, being Anglican. So I was like, I can't believe this. And I was like, no, denying her, pushing her apart. When she started to talk about Medjugorje, I didn't like it and things like that. But then one day, we always went together to a restaurant called the Luncheon Place. This is for English people from London, if you listen to it, close to Victoria Road in the heart of Kensington. And it was a very posh restaurant then in 2000. You know, people like Mick Jagger and Princess Diana went there. And we liked to go there because we saw these celebrities around and we enjoyed and we were gossiping and things. So she said, come over, let's have lunch in the lunches then. And I will explain to you all about Medjugorje and everything what happens there. So I went there. It was her and her sister. And we were chatting and they were really, really, really trying to convince me to join them in the next trip. They were going to do a pilgrimage. And I was like, no way, it's not for me. I don't care. And that middle of the conversation, I was eating pasta, I remember, with mushrooms. And suddenly I heard this incredible voice. It was a voice in the deepest of my heart. I know it came from a woman's voice, very sweet, very tender, full of love. I cannot describe, I don't find the words, even in Spanish, it's difficult for me to find the words. And she said to me, hey, why are you so scared of me? Why don't you come? I'm waiting for you. And I was like, what? I remember I threw my fork and my spoon and everything on the plate. And I was like, who talked to me in Spanish? Because I was speaking in English with my friends. So I turned around and in my bag was Mick Jagger with a wife and with their baby. I was like, whoa, this is, I'm sure Mick Jagger wasn't the one who talked to me. And I remember the wife was very, very beautiful. And they had a baby boy called Gabriel. I don't know how old is Gabriel now, but they were with the child, no? So I was like, what is going on here? And at the same time, I felt my heart really pounding, boom, 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 boom. And all these feelings came up into my heart, like, I have to go. So from one spoon to the other, one bite for the other, I said, hey, guys, you know what? Okay, send me the ticket. I'm joining the pilgrimage. And they were like, really? So one of them immediately said, okay, you are going to regret very soon. So give me your number, your number of your passport. I'm going to buy the ticket. I'm going to put your name inside the pilgrimage. The sooner the better, because otherwise you're going to regret.
Yes. So. Okay, so just for our listeners to get to understand this experience, because it's already so amazing and it just has started, but you didn't hear like with your ears, it was just something coming from your heart?
That's correct, Gabriel. It was a voice that, it was like speaking into my soul. It's the only way I have to describe it. It's very, very difficult because I didn't listen it with my ears. With my physical ears, it was like in my soul. I'm a Catholic. I've been baptized since I was born. So I think the Holy Spirit was trying to work it out and to help me to join the Lord. I was very far away from Him. So I think Our Lady worked through that way. I don't know. I'm sure it was Our Lady. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm sure there was something going on there. But now, okay, so you decide to go to Medjugorje and then...
When I came home, I told my husband that was the first miracle, because it was difficult for me to leave him with three babies. He was a very hardworking man. We didn't have a lot of help in the house. It was difficult in London, so it was a mess. And immediately, without hesitating, he said to me, go, it's going to help you a lot. And he's not into apparitions. He's not the typical man who likes Fatima or Lourdes. He thinks that's strange. And he's, as I said, a nuclear engineer. So, you know, it has to be everything rationalized. But he said, go. And now, after all these years, when I said, the name of my husband is Jose Joseph. And I said, Jose, why did you say yes? And he said, I just said, go and enjoy. You're not going to be hurt, because the NATO soldiers were there. And he has seen all this, the newspapers and the TV news. And he said, now the NATO is there, is protecting everyone. So it's not that worrisome for you to leave. You know? So I was like, this is strange, but it was like a magnet. I mean, the whole story was like, I don't want to go, but I have to go. I don't want to join this trip, but I have to join this trip. I hated airplanes. I always been scared of airplanes. And when I went there, I was really scared. The airplane was, you know, with a lot, mm-hmm. very bumpy flight. Wow. And then is when, in the airplane, going to Croatia, when I felt that the devil got really angry, because in my heart, I felt I didn't have to go. So I was very grumpy. I started to telling my friends off and tell my Anglican friend, why you convinced me? I left my husband with three children. The typical friend from hell, because I was putting all the problems. And everybody was like, this is the only Catholic of the group, and she's really a pain in the neck. And there was a beautiful priest there who was afterwards was my first spiritual confessor and spiritual advisor, Father Michael Omani. I adore him. He has been a father to me. And he was laughing because he was seeing that the Lord was going to work something on me, because I was the worst one in the group. So,
okay, so you were complaining all the time and you were the typical friend that nobody would like to travel with.
Yeah.
All right.
All the rest were on cloud nine. They were so happy to be there. I was the grumpy one. So when we arrived to the village, it was hard because, as I said, there was a lot of soldiers. The atmosphere was a war atmosphere. We crossed a lot of tanks, soldiers everywhere, and my heart broke out when I saw all these, the walls of the houses full of bullets everywhere. Children really on rags. I mean, the war was not that distant in 2000. So when we arrived to the village, I was really nervous. I mean, 90% of the population around us were soldiers, or people in military suits and things, no? Uniforms. So I was like, what on earth I am doing here? So the first 2 days I was very uneasy. I was, you know, very worried, taking pictures, not listening to the teachings that this priest, this Catholic priest, was trying to teach the group. So I was very confused, really. And the day after we arrived, I couldn't sleep. I'm very, very tall. I'm a very tall woman. But the houses, there were no pensions. I mean, the house, very, very humble people from Medjugorje. They were very humble families. And they accepted us in our houses. They lent us the rooms for a little money. So now you can find the hotels, but not at that time. So it was like in this very ugly and this village, shabby little village, I cannot even sleep. I want to go back to London, not to my beautiful apartment. And that day we went to mass, and that was the second miracle, because it was the first time ever that I saw a concelebrated mass. There was a lot of priests. All of my life I saw one priest in the mass, but they were like 100. And I was like, what is going on here? And the priest of our group got into the altar. We arrived a little tiny late, like 2 or 3 minutes late. So he waited, I have to run. So he went back to the altar. And I saw his habit, incredibly beautiful, sky blue, with a huge white cross. And it was like a bulb of heaven. And I was like, wow, he looks so handsome. And it was a very old man. But the light, and I thought, wow, I like that habit. I wonder why the rest of the priests don't wear that habit, no? That was the first real strange thing. And I couldn't, my eyes was following Father Michael, and I wanted that light. I was like attracted to him. So the mass ended, they said, let's go to the back of the church. You are going to listen to one of the visionaries talk about how he sees Our Lady. And then I said, now I'm going to get him, because I'm the daughter of a very, very important psychiatrist. So I said, this time I'm going to get him in his lies.
That's amazing. But I have to say that your story seems to me like God really wanted you. You had some experiences that are not the typical, you know, when you find people that have converted from one religion to another, or from atheism or whatever, they don't have these kind of signs. And how do you live having these signs in your life? Do you feel like special or something for God? Or
at that point I was very confused. I didn't understand, and I was not believing anything at all. Even as I said to you, when I went to visit with this group of friends, this visionary, I thought, I'm gonna catch him in a lie. But then God acted, and it was walking outside the church. We went outside the church. It was a beautiful day. The birds were chirping and the sun was shining. Beautiful May Day. And from 1 second to the other, I lost control of time. This is the only way that I can describe it, because it's super, super difficult to describe it. But we were walking in a group, and suddenly I stopped listening to the chipping of the birds, or my friends laughing, or talking of people, you know, walking around. Everything stopped. Like when you see a movie and something gets in the middle of the camera, and everything stops for a second. Mm-hmm. That's exactly what I felt. And I thought, what's going on? And I looked around, and everybody was like this, like stones.
Frozen.
Frozen in time, frozen in space. It was so strange. And in that precise moment, I felt this urge to look up into to the sky. I didn't see the Lord, of course, but I felt the most humongous love I have ever felt in my whole complete total life falling onto me. It was like, boom, like a shower of love. Like it was not water. I say it's more like dew, you know, dew. So this dew of love just fell all over me, my hair. So I felt like starting to be wet with love. It was love, love, pure love. And it was like, what's going on? What is this love? And it was so, so strong, this love, that it was far more powerful than the incredible love I felt for my husband or my babies. Or it was bigger than that. It was humongous. It was eternal. And in that precise moment, I heard again inside my soul, not in my ears, the voice. I knew exactly, with no kind of doubt, that it was Jesus talking to me, which is very strange, because I didn't have any relation with Jesus. I didn't understand the Eucharist, for example, or the sacraments in general. So Jesus was very distant in my mind and in my soul. God the Father was like impossible to understand. And I don't want to describe to you what the Holy Spirit was for me. It was like the super incredible mystery of the world, no? But Jesus was so familiar then, and he talked to me, and he said, this is how much I love you. And I almost died, Gabriel. It was like, wow, I mean, ooh, and in that moment, now talking to you, I feel my hair stand on end. And in that moment, boom, I felt this beautiful love that was showing me the whole life. My whole life, like a movie, went in front of my eyes. From an age, you can feel, you understand your sinning. For example, six years, 5 years, when you know that hitting a little boy in the kindergarten is bad, and then the teacher comes and tells you off. Since then, I saw taka, 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 very quickly, taka, taka, like sequences, like scenes of a movie. And then came a lot of sins that I knew they were bad, but I didn't give them importance in my life. I thought they were like normal things, no? A lot of confusion in the adolescent time. I was a model when I was very young, and that gave me huge vanity. So I was cruel with other girls that were maybe chubby or not as pretty as that the society thought they could be. So I was cruel, and that cruelty, that little things, cruelty here, or for women, we are very bad talking with friends, bad things about others, slandering, gossiping. That's very bad in the eyes of God, no? And I also felt the pain of Jesus, because all of that sins, the wedding, I didn't care about preparing myself properly for that incredibly important sacrament, no? Everything. I understood that God, nobody can hide from God. God sees everything. Even if we forget, He doesn't. So I was so scared, and I felt so incredibly embarrassed that I wanted to cry out, like, forgive me, what is going on here? So I think I felt my judgment, my private judgment. After many years, I talked to people who are alive, but they were about to die for a car crash or a ski accident or whatever, and they almost died, and they told me exactly the same. You know, I was about to fall into this very dangerous cliff. Boom, all my life came, and I felt the same thing. So I think the Lord gave me this opportunity to see how the judgment will be for each one of us when we die.
I'm so amazed, Maria, about this experience. How long did it last?
In my that's a very interesting question, Gabriel, because in my mind, in my brain, in my understanding, it could be like 10 minutes. But the information inside what I received could be for writing two encyclopedias. I mean, the information is humongous. You understand a lot of things of the soul, of sinning, of loving properly, of things that can hurt God. That is enormous. I mean, the information is enormous. But in my brain, it was 10 minutes. But it wasn't, because when everything was over, I wanted to cry out, as I said. And I said, Lord, please forgive me, forgive me. I want to love you. And He said, this is how much I love you, that love I was feeling through that dew of love. But nobody responds to it. And it finished, clack, like that. So when I came out of this dream or ecstasy, I don't know how to call it, this mystic thing, I looked at my watch, and only 3 seconds elapsed. Only 3 seconds. And in my brain, I thought it was 10 minutes. But in reality, it was eternal. Then after a lot of learning, many theologians have told me, well, God is eternal. He's the Alpha and the Omega. In God, time is not like our time. In heaven, time is eternal. It's different. So in our brain as humans, we don't understand it properly. But my heart was broken. I mean, I felt completely abandoned. I thought, God is not going to forgive me. I had my last confession was on my wedding day, and it was like 10 years back, you know. And the poor priest was begging in the breakfast time, he was begging me to have confession. And I said, no way, I'm not going to tell my secrets to you. I don't know you. You're a stranger to me. And since that moment, I was crying my eyes out. When we arrived to this, it's a huge party behind the church, where the visionary Jack of the youngest was giving his testimony, and we started to talk. Then I burst into tears, and I couldn't stop. It was like, there were rivers and rivers of tears, but tears of pain, no? And all of my friends thought that I was sick. I said, now she's crying because she's sick. My soul was sick. So since that moment, I was following the steps of this priest who became one of my best friends ever. He still is. Begging him for the confession. And he said, now you want to confess, but you were insulting me in the morning. I was like, Father, do you have to confess me? So that is how my soul woke up.
That's amazing, Maria. Thanks for sharing with us, because I'm sure a lot of people would like to hear this story, which is amazing, and which shows the love of God to all of us. But I would like to ask you just one detail. After you had this vision, did you need to be alone? Did you need to talk a lot with your friends there? What was your reaction to that moment?
I was very confused for a long time, Gabriel, because in Medjugorje after that experience, especially after the confession, I felt relief. It was like a huge rucksack full of stones was taking out from my back. So I felt very light, but very sad at the same time, because I understood I have lost a lot of time. I was 32, 33, and I've lost a lot of time. So when I went back to London, I was very confused. And what I felt was hunger of God. I needed to eat God, basically eat and drink the blood of God. So this priest who immediately became my first spiritual advisor, he helped me tremendously because he taught me from day one the rosary, the sacraments. He explained to me a lot of things of the catechism of the Catholic Church, which I had completely forgotten from since school. And also I was in this Anglican country, so we didn't have a lot of Catholic churches around. So I had to find the one closest to home. And it was a magnet. I went, for example, for groceries to the shop. And then I came back from the groceries with two bags full of groceries for home. And then I saw the door open of the church. I was like, oh my God, it's open. And this magnet took me inside the church and I saw the Blessed Sacrament there. It was the first time ever I saw the Blessed Sacrament exposed in the monstrance. And I was attracted to it and I cried and cried. And I sat on the front row, in the front pew of the church. And I prayed and I cried and I said, God, forgive me. I want to be better. I want to know you better. I need to eat you every day. And when I look back into my watch, 2 hours had flown away. Because my soul was so incredibly connected to that monstrance. And that is how I fell in love with adoration, Eucharistic adoration.
What did your family think about you returning to London and watching you were absolutely changed? How was the impact
It was very hard, Gabriel, because my husband was the one like, oh my God, she got completely nuts, you know, and some drugs. The soldiers gave him some drugs or something. I was the same person, but my priorities have changed completely. I needed to go every day to Mass, so the gym was not that important anymore. Friends were very important, but I lost a lot of friends because they felt I was different. I didn't want to go to parties all the time. I didn't want to spend all that money in good restaurants and a lot of beautiful clothes. I thought I needed less clothes than I had. I didn't want to have a lot of pairs of shoes. It was not necessary. You know, these little things that God very, very sweetly and in a very tender way, little by little, is erasing from your heart, from your life, things that he doesn't like. And little by little, I was changing. So many friends said, oh, you're getting so boring. You only speak about God or about how important it is to pray the rosary and how important it is to teach the children about God. And we want to party. So this big change was super, super difficult. I suffered a lot of solace, a lot of loneliness, because my husband, he reached to a point that he got really angry and he said, you are always thinking about God and this is too much. I don't understand why on earth you have to go to Mass every day. I need you at home. And so it was hard. And I suffered a lot. It's been 20 years, Gabriel, but after 5 years, the wounds inside my heart were very hard because I felt very lonely. And I said, God, if you want me to follow you, I hate to be lonely. Please send me friends. And it was beautiful because a lot of new friends came into my life, people of God, you know, Catholics, Anglicans, Protestant people, Christians that loved God so much. And we shared my love for Our Lady and they were very respectful. And then I came back to live in Spain. It was very hard in Spain. And also I've been slandered a lot. I tried to share, as I'm doing with you and all the American people or English-speaking people, my testimony. And many of my family members, many of my friends since ever in Madrid didn't like it. So they pushed me apart and it was hard because I was very much slandered. Now, after 20 years, I think it was necessary. I've suffered a lot. It hasn't been funny. It hasn't been fun at all. But maybe God needed me to go through purgatory because I was like that before. I was the criticized and the gossip one before. So I think God...
Now they were gossiping about you.
Yes. Yes. Now I was receiving this slandering and this gossip, and this priest friend of mine was telling me, offer it up, offer it all up to the Lord. Don't complain. Don't defend yourself. But I was very vain. I still had my sins, and I was attached to, my pride. So it was hard. It was hard. I mean, the school of the Lord, the school of our Lady is also a school of pain. You suffer, but you need to suffer to clean all the wounds and all the bad things you had in your soul in order to be better and better and better and get closer and closer to the cross. Because without the cross, I understood we are not going to go to heaven at all.
Maria, this is something I would like to enhance for our listeners, because when someone thinks about conversion, you know, we only tend to keep the beautiful part, you know, the nice experiences and the love and everything. But there's a lonely way, you know, you have to walk through, and they had to know that many times they have to forget friends, forget habits, forget tendencies or anything, change it all. Just to seek for God. So I would like you to send them a message of courage, you know, to make this way.
Yeah, of course. To our listeners and viewers, I will say that we have to be brave. There's a lot I discovered learning with this priest. I discovered that there is a lot of gifts from the Holy Spirit, and one of them is fortitude. I think we have to ask for the Holy Spirit gifts to survive in this world, because it's a hard battle, and it's not a battle that we see. We are surrounded by supernaturality, and the devil is very strong, and there are a lot of bad angels, fallen angels, that want to get us away from this conversions and this love of God. So we are in war. We are living a war, a supernatural, a spiritual war, and we have to be defended by the gifts of the church and the gifts of the Holy Spirit. So we have to ask for that as a very important thing. Also, we have to pray. To pray and to receive the Holy Sacrament is super important. It's essential. We cannot go forward if we don't confess, if we don't take the sacraments in our hands, in our heart. And to trust is so important, to trust, because we are so wounded when people stab us and they slander us, say, oh, she's crazy, or she's having drugs, or whatever they want to say about us, that we need that. We really need that to be very strong, very brave. And all that gifts are not from ourselves. They all come from God. So God is not going to abandon us. We all need to know that Our Lady will never abandon us through a weapon. And I call it the Kalashnikov. The Kalashnikov of Our Lady is the Holy Rosary. I have a lot of medals. They're little gifts that people give to me. This is the Kalashnikov of Our Lady. Every single little bead of the rosary is a bullet in the front of the head of the devil. So if we pray the rosary, we are protected. I tell my friends that if we pray the rosary, it's like a chain that, you know, put this in the neck of the devil. So the devil is going to be like a dog barking, really angry, but he cannot bite because this rosary is pulling him apart. So all these weapons are from the Catholic Church, from Our Lady, from the saints. We have to pray the saints for intercession, which is, this is very difficult for Protestants to understand, but we Catholics, we consider the saints our friends in heaven, and we pray to them, we don't adore them, we just ask them for help, and the whole heaven is helping us in this humongous battle here on earth.
Maria, I really love the passion you put on your words, because I'm sure you live it. It's obvious that you live it. This is not a lie. I would like you to finally, because I know this can be long, and I would make you a lot of questions, but I don't want you to spend it all. You know, many times we can talk about this, but this time I would like to finish talking about the maternity of church, because you were a lost child and then you found this church that had, you know, a lot of presence for free for all of us. What did you find when you returned to the church?
Oh, I found a lot of love. I had a very, very huge luck. Let's say God protected me, because I found saints in my path, a very good priest. I know, and as a Catholic, I suffer a lot, like everybody of us. We suffer because of the problems of the church, all the problems with, you know, sexual problems with very bad priests that sadly it has been all discovered. But I think it was necessary to clean that. We have a wonderful Pope, Benedict XVI, who really tried. Now Francisco is really tried, the Holy Father. So I was very lucky, because the people I met, the confessors I had, the spiritual advisor I found, were like a gift to me. They have been helping me day by day. When I started to write, I didn't say, Gabriel, that I wrote after that 13 books based on the Lord. Maybe I said it, but they were eschatological, very difficult themes, because I was very interested in purgatory, in heaven and hell, and I wrote about that. And then I had some problems with some priests, because some of them, to my astonishment, they didn't believe in these dogmas. They are dogmas. I didn't invent them. They were dogmas. So also inside the priesthood, there's confusion right now. So after 20 years, there has been ups and downs. It has been a roller coaster to me, because there were times when I was super happy, super protected, but then I was, you know, very much attacked, even from people from the church. But then after that, everything was cleared up and I went back up again. And I think this is the life of the apostles. For a while, I was hungry. I said, why am I attacked from the people inside now? But I think this is the life. If you want to be an apostle, and I said this to everyone who is listening to us, if you want to follow Jesus, and if you want to carry his cross to be the Cyrene, who is from behind trying to grab and to help him to go up the Calvary, you are going to receive a spat from people, or you are going to receive a punch, because you are close to God. And we have to live knowing that.
That's difficult. That's one of the most difficult parts of following Jesus. He never said it's going to be easy, but he said it's going to be a happy ending for sure, yeah, on heaven, yeah, with him. That's what we are trying to look for. Well, Maria, thank you so much for your testimony. I really enjoyed this time, and I want you to repeat us some parts. You know, we can go for more details next time. So we will talk about it in English also. So thank you, and see you next time, Maria.
See you next time, Gabriel. Thank you so much. And I kiss and I hug all my American friends, all my friends from Harvard, Jim Caviezel, who I met after he filmed The Passion. We will talk about that in another podcast. And I love you all. And please believe me, I'm not crazy. I'm just in love with God.
Crazy of love. Thank you so much, Maria. See you next time.
Bye. God bless you all. God bless you all.
God bless you. Bye. You've just listened to Faith with Magnifying Glass with Gabriel López Nieto and Maria Vallejo Nájera.